Before we actually start building our game, let's have a look at how Scratch's code blocks work. This is the code pane where all of Scratch's blocks live. As we scroll down this long list, you can see that the blocks are organized according to color. Each color represents a different kind of command. These blue blocks all have to do with motion and moving around, how your sprites move and rotate on the screen. These purple looks blocks all have to do with what your sprites look like. How big are they? Which costume are they wearing? Are they visible or not? These pink sound blocks control music and sound effects, what sounds are playing, what the volume is, and factors like that. We'll talk a little bit more about the other blocks as we work, but for now, just remember that color is important. There are more than 100 blocks on your screen, which can seem a little overwhelming at first, but if you're looking to play a sound, you only have to search these 9 pink sound blocks to find what you need. These colored bubbles at the far left side of your screen are shortcuts that will take you right to the category you're looking for. I showed you earlier how blocks attach to each other a little bit like Lego. Once they're attached together, blocks will always stick to the ones below them. So grab them by the top block to move them around, and grab them by the lower blocks to tear them apart. You can delete a block by clicking on it with the delete key on your keyboard, but it's usually easier just to toss them back into the bin where you found them. So in the introduction, you saw the kind of game we're going to be building here today. We want to program the cat to move around the screen, following our mouse cursor wherever it goes, so that when I point at any spot on the screen, the cat will run towards that position until he touches my mouse cursor. Our mice are going to have their own set of instructions. We won't be telling them where to go, but instead we'll be programming them to follow a very simple set of instructions and move around the screen under the computer's control. We're going to start by programming the cat. Click on the picture of the cat in the sprite pane until it turns blue. It's really important when you're giving your sprites commands that you put the right block on the right sprite. Scratch is what's known as an object-oriented programming language, meaning that each object or sprite that you program has its own list of commands. If I put a block down in one sprite, it only affects the actions of that sprite. When I click off to another sprite, that block is no longer visible, and it has no effect on that sprite. So the first block we usually use to start a new project is this green flag block, which you can find by clicking the yellowish button marked Events. One thing you'll notice about event blocks is that most of them have a little curve across the top. That's there to signal to you that you can't attach something to the top of it, because these are starter blocks that command other blocks to start doing something, so everything else connects below them. In the case of this green flag block, think of it as being connected to this smaller green flag that's right above the gameplay area. When you click on that flag, it sends a signal to this block telling it to run all the commands that are underneath it, one at a time, until it's done. In a minute, we're going to tell our cat to move forward, but if we want to be able to steer it around, we first have to get it pointing in the direction we want it to go. I'm going to tell my cat that when I click on the green flag, I want it to turn to face my mouse cursor. Under our blue motion blocks, you'll see a block here about halfway down that's called Point Towards Mouse Pointer, which will make our cat spin around and face our cursor. When I attach the block to the green flag and click to activate it, you'll see that not a lot happens. The first time I click on the flag, it does what I told it to, spinning around to face my cursor at the top left of the screen, but then it just kind of sits there doing nothing. Even if I click the green flag again, nothing new happens, because he's already facing in the direction we told him to go. And now the program has ended, so there's no chance to do anything else. What we're actually trying to get the cat to do here is to keep doing the same action, pointing at our cursor, over and over again so that when I move my cursor to a new location, it keeps spinning instead of just doing it once. So how do we do that? In order to get this working, we're going to need to use something called a loop.
If I want to make Scratch look like he's walking, I can use this block to change his costume. When I click on it, my character changes his animation to make it appear he's moving his feet. If I want him to take two steps, I can use a second block and keep adding more and more blocks to make him take more and more steps. But what if I want him to take hundreds of steps? Fortunately, one of the things computers are really good at is repetitive tasks. In coding, the tools we use to repeat the same actions over and over again are called loops. Scratch has lots of different kinds of loops, but today we're going to use this one called forever. Notice that it's shaped a little like a letter C. It looks that way to let you know that you can put other blocks inside of it. Anything you put inside a forever loop will just keep happening over and over and over again until you tell it to stop. Instead of using hundreds of blocks, I can use just two blocks to make my sprite move hundreds of times.
All right, so now that we know all about loops, let's go looking for one. You'll find the forever loop here under the light orange blocks called control. Let's just drop it down here for a second while we rearrange our blocks. The action we want to be repeating is the cat pointing at your mouse cursor. So drag that block inside the loop and now reattach it to the green flag. So if you follow the path of the code from here, you can see that when we press the green flag, the code will spin your character to face your cursor. And when it's done, it will see that it's in a loop and swing around to do it again and again. Let's click the green flag and see what that looks like. Awesome! One little Scratch trick I haven't mentioned yet is if you want to see your game in a slightly bigger view, you can click on this button up here at the top, and that will maximize your screen. This will give you a nice full screen view for maximum fun while playing. There's a couple of other buttons up here that also control the size of your play area. If you're working on a computer with a very small screen, like a Chromebook, you might want to compress your play area a bit by clicking on this button that gives you just a little bit more room to code. The button next to it reverts back to the original view. So what's our next step in getting this cat to behave the way we want it to? I'm going to give you guys a few minutes to try and figure out what the next block is that we're going to have to use to get this character's motion working properly. I'm going to pause for a second here to let you catch up with the code on my screen and start to think about next steps.